Let me join all of you in extending my heartiest congratulations to Mr. Surya Prakash for this wonderful book, which has already been described as already controversial. But this is the first comprehensive, independent, and incisive analysis of the MPLAB scheme. I hope it will generate more debate. What Mr. Arun Soarikji has said reflects the perception of the people of India. People are not happy with this. I know it. But in a democracy, once you have given something, it is practically impossible to take it back. So we have to, good or bad, we have to live with that and improve the whole system. May I now request the author of Public Money and Private Agenda, Mr. Surya Prakash, to speak about his own book.
अभी आदरणीय जयराम रमेश जी ने एक एमपीलैड का 1,00,000 रुपया लिया है रांची में, एक बस खरीदी गई है, वो वहाँ आदिवासी बच्चे हैं उनके लिए, कोई बात नहीं, अच्छा काम हो रहा
सर। योर एक्सीलेंसी मिस्टर शिवराज पाटिल, मिस्टर किशोर चंद्र देव, मिस्टर संगमा, मिस्टर अरुण शौरी दोल जी एंड मिस्टर कपीश मेहरा, ladies and gentlemen, many senior parliamentarians and friends from media who are here, I really thank all of you for being here this evening. I wish to make a few comments on some of the observations made by the distinguished speakers. One is, Mr. Dev has said that the guidelines have been changed and misused and guidelines should not be flouted. Actually, that is the virtually the central point of the book. And of course, Mr. Arun Shauri has said that we need to look at MPLAD with a sharper eye. Mr. Shivraj Patil has spoken about the separation of powers issue, which has been tackled by the Supreme Court in its judgment and so on. He agrees that there are problems in the implementation of MPLADs and the way MPs go about their business in this regard. But he thinks that this is a scheme that must be given a try, and as I have discussed with him earlier also, he feels that there is need for a certain amount of pressure and this thing to keep schemes going in a certain way, and this kind of scrutiny and critique of the work of Parliament and schemes of this nature is very critical in the larger public interest. That is generally the view that he holds. And I wish to make a few points in regard to this book. I felt the need to examine this whole issue because it was started 20 years ago. I think after 20 years it's a good sort of milestone, you know, it's a good point at which you can reflect over what has happened over the years. Today, members of parliament totally get 4,000 crores a year by way of these funds. It does not come directly to them, it goes to the district authorities, but it is spent on their advice. 4,000 crores, you know, at one time meant $1 billion, but with the rupee sliding down, it's sort of, in dollar terms, it's not as much as it used to be. But the problem is, you see, after MPLADs was launched 20 years ago, it spawned MLA lands. So in all states you have MLA lands. There are 4,807 MPs and MLAs in India. Our MPs get 4,000 crores a year as MPLADs scheme funds. And our MLAs gets anywhere between 1 crore to 4 crores, which on an average of 2 crores works out to about 8,000 crores a year. So together I think our parliamentarians and legislators have something like 12,000 crores at their disposal for spending on local area development. I think this is a lot of money, and there is need for scrutiny. And we as citizens, I think we have a responsibility to keep an eye on how this money is spent. And I think Parliament and state legislatures have the responsibility to ensure that these funds are utilized in the best manner possible. I also think that as citizens, we have the right to demand transparency and accountability in the utilization of these funds. Sir, as everybody is aware, in fact, Mr. Chowdhury was just mentioning, you know, almost close to 24 crores, Mr. Chowdhury, the money that he got as MPLAD, it went to the Biosciences and Bioengineering Department of IIT Kanpur and the Environmental Sciences and Environmental Engineering Department of IIT Kanpur for developing a separate building and for developing the facilities there. So there are several members of Parliament like Mr. Chowdhury who have utilized this for this kind of projects, but there are a lot of members of Parliament, especially the Lok Sabha MPs, who spend it on smaller projects in their constituencies in the hope that the people will remember the work they have done and that this will help them in the subsequent elections. In my view, one troubling aspect of MP lands is the frequency with which the guidelines are flouted. Actually, MP lands was launched when Mr. Shivaraj Patil became Speaker. He was the first one who drew up the guidelines. My view is that if you just stick to the guidelines drawn up by Mr. Patil 20 years ago, there is very little chance of badnam of members of Parliament. What has happened over the last 20 years is the dilution of those guidelines because of constant pressure of members of Parliament. The MPLADS committees of Lok Sabha and Rajya Sabha have been putting pressure on the government, and slowly over the years, that framework which had been created 20 years ago, more or less, you see, is non-existent now. I'll give you two examples. One, the very important rule that Mr. Patil laid down as Speaker, this money must be spent on government projects. This money should not be put into private trust societies or any kind of private activity. No money should be spent on private land. In the last few years, because of pressure of MPs, that rule has, first the rule was violated. And as the number of violations grew, someday somebody decided we might as well amend them. The next thing that happened was, they started spending this on the private trusts of the MPs themselves. This is a very serious matter as citizens and as members of Parliament. In fact, here in this audience today, there are many friends of ours from Parliament who are very sensitive citizens and concerned citizens and would not like this to happen. And I'm sure we need to take their help in order to deal with this problem. We should not allow members of Parliament to spend this money, which is 5 crores a year, into their own family trust to run engineering colleges or schools or, you know, hospitals or whatever. Because nowadays in our politics, we have seen that there is a certain infrastructure that is now built up in order to get elected and come to the Lok Sabha. One is you must have schools, primary schools, high schools, then you must have an engineering college, you must have a medical college, you must have a teacher's training institute, and this, that and the other. Usually, political families have 3-4 trusts, and they also have a little hospital, this, that growing, and some bit of social, on the social sectors and things. And if MPLADS funds are allowed to be spent on that, then what happens is public money is poured into that, and that is shown as the munificence of that family, political family, and then you see they hope to return to Parliament that way. I think this is totally improper, and as citizens I think we have a responsibility to monitor this. The other point I wish to make is that if you look at the Kishore Chandra Dev committee, luckily, happily, Mr. Dev is here with us today in this meeting. He headed that committee which probed the improper conduct of MPs in the spending of MP lands, and four of them were punished by way of suspensions and this, that and the other. And I just wish to draw your attention to one or two points that this committee made. It first said that the role of MPs in recommending works for execution cannot strictly be said to relate to their parliamentary duties. This is one point. The other is it said that every vibrant democracy demands that those who wield power as elected legislators should use it for the public good and not make it an instrument of self-seeking. This is the Kishore Chandra Dev Committee of Parliament, and this is the opinion of this committee, and this is the opinion of Parliament which has accepted the committee's opinion, and therefore I think we must demand that Parliament stick to this sentence in the Kishore Chandra Dev Committee report, saying it must be used only for public good and not as an instrument of self-seeking. The other point is, the committee has said that members of Parliament can do effectively by personifying the highest standards of personal integrity, probity and rectitude. It reminded every MP that an elected representative of people, a member status is an exalted one. A dignified and ethical conduct by a legislator is one of the primary obligations of a member of Parliament. Any misconduct by a legislator, whether inside the House or outside, not only projects a legislator in poor light, but also strikes at the very credibility of the democratic institution. Therefore, the committee went on to say that the strength of any system lies in the capacity to promptly correct aberrations which may creep in from time to time. That is why I say that we have faith in our Parliament, because we have committees of Parliament which look into this now. 10, 20 years ago it was not happening. Now a certain amount of policing has come in, and somewhere we saw even in the cash for questions thing and in the MPLATS thing, this, given these observations of the committee, I will say it sort of reinforces our faith in Parliament. Two other points, sir, I'll wind up quickly. Many of us think whether India has any influence at all in this world, and whether, you know, we impact things that happen elsewhere, whether anyone ever looks at us, sees us as models. I must tell you that we were launched MP Lads in 1993. And 2 years hence, Zambia launched a similar scheme. Kenya in 2003, Tanzania 2008, Uganda 2005, Sudan 2007, Bhutan 2009, Jamaica 2007. A number of African countries have adopted MPLATS. I don't know whether they have adopted any other things that we have done in this country, but this is one scheme that has become extremely popular among parliamentarians, largely in this developing world. Now, sir, I am most grateful for our distinguished guest here, Mr. Shivraj Patil, as he was mentioning. Actually, he was instrumental in, you know, some two or three big ticket issues. One was televising of Parliament, two, the committee system. Actually, today we must really thank him, you know, for this committee system which is now running for 20 years. Because today I think if at all you see some work in Parliament, that work is happening in committees. Mr. Kishore Chandra Dev was heading this committee. Apart from that, he is one of the senior most parliamentarians in the committee in the country, and you know, a person who enjoys great credibility in our public life. And really, it's a very happy thing to have him in our midst. Mr. Purna Sangma is, of course, one of the most popular speakers we had, and a person with a great experience in our parliamentary life, and with the right attitude to democracy, in a sense. And more important than that, he is here because he is Purna Sangma. Mr. Arun Chowdhury. Mr. Arun Chowdhury, my editor in the Indian Express and my guru in journalism and in what I call Journalism Plus, that is this book and whatever else I am going to do in life in the coming years in the writing field. He has been a great source of inspiration and great encouragement. In fact, I got down to specializing in parliament because when I did a couple of stories for the Indian Express articles, looking at attendance in the Lok Sabha when during passage of bills, and I argued that there is never quorum when parliament makes law for the people of India. And he as editor had it on the front page, and you know, it was his encouragement that time which got me thinking about the institution of parliament. And sir, it's really, I really thank you for being here today for this thing. Apart from this, a lot of people to thank: the Vivekananda International Foundation, Mr. Ajit Doval, director, for providing me a platform to do work in the area of democracy studies. All of you who are present here today, my friends and well-wishers, and you know, members of my family who have flown in from Bangalore and Chennai, Mr. R.K. Mehra, Kapish Mehra, Rupa, and Ms. Elena Mazumdar, the commissioning editor, for making this book possible. Sir, officials of the Parliament Secretariat, whom I always lean on and chat up, and have, we have great interaction with them, and many of whom are here today, I thank them. Also, a lot of friends in the Library of Parliament who are a great help for any of us who want to do some serious work in this area. So I really thank all of you for being here and for having made this thing possible, and for all the guests. Thank you.
We are coming to an item for which every one of us has been waiting. Want to thank Mr. Mehra.